Hello. This is our third week of the Imagination in Action series. We're continuing through the works of Lent. So we started with kind of our introduction to the series. Last week we talked about prayer, and this week we're going to talk about fasting. Fasting is one of the classic works of Lent. We're thinking of it as giving something up. It could be food or other things. And as with all of them, I'm working with short stories or stories. Some of them are longer than others. But this week, it's a book by G.K. Chesterton called Man Alive. Man Alive is kind of, it's a short story or a long short story about kind of this, well, the question is he crazy or not? This man that comes in to this household and kind of disturbs everything. It's kind of this boarding house, and there's the different guests, and this new person arrives and throws everything into chaos. He arrives in the presence of a great wind, which is kind of a symbol of what he'll do. And then the question becomes, as they begin to go through his life and different things, has he done? Is he crazy or is he not? G.K. Chesterton is a writer that I very much like, an English writer. He came just before Tolkien or C.S. Lewis. Wrote a lot of articles. He was a journalist, but then lots of stories, short stories. His Father Brown mysteries are kind of like Sherlock Holmes, but the main detective is Father Brown, a Catholic priest. Lots of writings. His writing, though, can be difficult to read, I think. It can be very dense. He loves paradoxes, clever phrases. He loves making reference to other stories and other things. And so I think Man Alive is very much that type of book. It can be, it's a dense book that I enjoyed, but certain sections I had to reread again to kind of try and get a sense of what he was talking about. Because again, it's very, I think, packed with meaning and references and an interesting way of looking at things. And this is really the ultimate point of the book. The point of the book is that the main character, called Innocent Smith, is not crazy, but he tries to disrupt the way that we come to see the world, or is the way that we kind of come to lose the freshness or the interest of the world. Boredom is kind of his main enemy. Or there's a phrase, acedia, or a classic word, acedia, which is often translated as sloth. But acedia has more to do with just kind of a dissatisfaction about spiritual things. Just kind of that feeling of dullness or that feeling, a lack of interest in the spiritual life. And that's, again, kind of, I think, the main enemy of the book, Man Alive, that the main character's whole goal is to do crazy things that help him to see the world again in a fresh way, to see common things in an uncommon way. For example, one of the things I want to mention is one of the things that he does is he takes a trip around the world to get to his house. And so, again, it's kind of crazy because it's like, well, he's at his house, but he, you know, he says, I've got to go and get to my house. And so he goes all the way around the whole world. And there's a phrase from it. So this is one of the books. I don't have a hard copy of it, but I have it on my Kindle. So I have a digital version of it here and the Kindle. But this phrase, he says, my pilgrimage is not yet accomplished. I have become a pilgrim to cure myself of being an exile. So this is one of kind of the main points of the book. What does he mean by that? So he says he had this experience of being an exile in his own home. In other words, as an exile is someone that's far away from their home, who's not able to access their home. And so what he said is the character in the book felt that even though he was living in his own home with his own family, he wasn't able to really appreciate them, that he had come to take them for granted, in a sense, and not see the beauty of his home, the goodness of his family, you know, the love with his wife, that he needed, in a sense, to take this pilgrimage around the world. And so when he got back, he could see them all with new eyes and be thankful and grateful for what it was that really was there, that, again, he had come to be unable to see. So the reason that I connect this with the theme of fasting for the this kind of one of the works of Lent is that fasting is about giving things up but is ultimately about setting us free in a certain way. That it's a solidarity with Christ and his suffering. It's a solidarity with the poor and those who go without. But that I think it should then also, therefore, lead us to a deeper gratitude about the things that we do have, to help to see the things that we have as gifts and not as something, again, that we take for granted. A phrase that Chesterton uses in lots of his writings, an image, is seeing the world upside down. I think most famous, it's in his biography of St. Francis of Assisi. It's quoted in a Mumford & Sons song that he came out of the cave walking on his hands, seeing the world upside down. That what he means by this is that seeing the world upside down means that the things that normally seem to be resting on the earth are hanging from the earth. When we look at things resting on the earth, the bigger and the heavier they are, the more solid they seem, the more firmly attached to the ground by gravity. However, when they're upside down, they seem to be hanging from the world, and the things that are therefore heavier seem to more easier to fall from the world. So what he means by this is, instead of trying to see that putting our trust in things, money, popularity, power, possessions, pleasure, whatever it might be, rather than seeing as that as a solid foundation for our life, we see that as a untrustworthy foundation for our life. That putting our trust and hopes in things that pass away and or are not permanent is not ultimately wise or a good foundation for trust. That instead we should put our trust in those things that really do last and endure. And so fasting, whether that's involving giving up something that's evil or shouldn't be in our life, or just giving up something that has too much power in our life, which is too distracting for our life, it can bring a freedom and a clarity. That I think if we imagine fasting in this way, it's more understandable. That it's not just suffering for suffering's sake, but it's suffering so that we can be more free to love, more free to appreciate with gratitude and the gifts and goodness that we have. So again, Man Alive is a very interesting story. I don't know if it would be for everyone, but the point of it I like very much. You know, that seeing, being able to see our world and our life with those eyes of appreciation, being able to say no to those things that are less important so that we can say yes to the things that are more important. This is the point of the story, and its ultimate fruit is joy, is life, is the ability to live our vocations and come to the fullness of life and bring the fullness of life for others. So let us take a moment to pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, you invite us during the time of Lent to embrace the spiritual practice of fasting. We pray that this may help us to enter into the love of Christ, who is willing to set aside all things for what was most important, who is free to love and to serve without being held back by lesser things. We ask your blessing and grace in those areas that we most struggle, those places that we need that renewal and that freedom. We ask this in the name of Christ, our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.